Hello, this is Austin Hetzler, the pastor of Christ the Rock Church of Elyria, Ohio. We at Christ the Rock are humbled and grateful to get to be a part of your sanctification today as you watch or listen to this sermon. But at the same time, we want to encourage you to be a member of a good local church and not to allow online sermons to replace the local church and to benefit from the life of that church and to give your spiritual gifts back to that church. Having said that, our website is www.christrockchurch.com. If you go there, you can find sermons, blogs, and other resources, as well as our location and service times. You can also listen to the sermons on Bible Thumping Wingnut, Podbean, iTunes, Google Play Music, iHeartRadio, and other podcast catchers. We also invite and encourage you to subscribe to our YouTube station. You can look it up, or you can use the link to it that's found on our website. I, along with a membership of Christ the Rock Church, sincerely pray that this sermon will be a blessing. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come together around your word once more. Lord, the spiritual DNA of your servants in the book of Acts is beautiful. It is an absolute delight and privilege to be able to observe the way that your Spirit works through them, what He made them to be, what they became, quite in spite of themselves. Trophies of grace. We thank you that your church is indomitable and that your people are too, because you are with us in our frailty, in our weakness, in all of our failings. You still use us to advance your great kingdom. We thank you for the privilege of being included in this work. We thank you for the privilege of learning about it through the testimony of the saints in your word. And I pray that you give me grace, Lord, so that I may convey these things to your people in an accurate and compelling way. Take me out of the way, Lord. Holy Spirit, please focus the hearts, minds, and souls of your people upon the text and let them see Christ in it once more. And I praise you and I thank you for all of these things. In Jesus' name, amen. Suffering is something that is avoided at all costs in our society. Whatever remains of Western civilization, and for however long it remains, we are primarily defined by decadence. And this is largely the result of technological advancements, the assembly line, industrial revolution. Everything is easier for us now, cheaper. Things that people in past generations once struggled for, we no longer do. This has produced a degree of collective wealth never before experienced in previous generations or even conceived of. And the last century saw a large proportion of humanity go from operating out of need to not really being able to comprehend need as a motivation for action, such that need motivated by action in America, in our day, has pretty well ceased to exist. No longer need to turn the dirt in order to procure basic provisions. Water, clean water, is not hard to come by. We have water on tap, we have food whether we work or not. In any circumstance, there are food banks, if nothing else, if we are not living by the grace, so-called, of the government. And this accounts for the astronomical swell of homelessness. In past civilizations, and some still present, homelessness was relegated to the indigent. You had to work to live, or else you would die, and so everybody who was normally situated in life did work. In the Bible, who do you see begging? You see invalids begging, who are invalids for one reason or another, but you don't see able-bodied people doing that. Those are the kinds of people who were homeless in the past. But in our context, even those who don't work, in contradiction to the teaching of Scripture, do in fact eat, and they often eat quite well. Even prisoners in America eat better and in some senses live better than a majority of people from time immemorial. And their food is provided for them by the state, that would be you and I. So even the pariahs in our society don't actually need. Now without need, there is still suffering, but certainly not the kind nor the same legitimate cause for it that our ancestors experienced. Yet upon even the briefest glance at human behavior, we see that whether we have cause to suffer or not, we need to suffer. Or at least we need to appear to be suffering and to believe that we are suffering and to have others believe that we are suffering as well. We are constantly told, for example, about marginalized people groups. And these, we are told, are people who are treated very poorly. And because of this, they are deserving of great pity and compassion and care and protection. And yet these modern marginalized people are quite unlike marginalized people groups of the past, in that, among other things, they aggressively seek inclusion in and identification with so-called marginalized people groups. We are oppressed, is the rallying cry of the people who aggressively pursued their own apparent oppression in the first place. I don't recall ever reading about Jews gleefully wearing Stars of David armbands so that the Nazis would know who they were so that they could send them to Auschwitz or Dachau or kill them or in some other way persecute them. Yet if so-called marginalized people in our day wore armbands, it would be voluntary and be a line around the block to buy them. Whoever manufactured the armbands would run out of them because they could not keep up with the demand. Fortunately for these people, Twitter handles with false pronouns are free and are in an endless supply. Now, the civil rights movement of the 1960s was a transcendent movement. So ethnic minorities were the targets of what was happening in our society and the persecution, but members of all ethnicities marched on their behalf. White people, hand in hand with black people, demonstrating for a righteous cause. This is not the kind of inclusion and identification that is common today. People, especially of the younger demographic, are personally identifying as members of some marginalized group or another, not marching on behalf of them, but denying reality itself in order to be them. This is why new letters are constantly being added to what used to be, in ancient times, LGBT. Now there's a category known as cisgender, which is just a heterosexual man. But we have to be included in the alphabet gang. Everybody needs to be included in this because everybody needs to have a place in the suffering, in the marginalization. But then the question is, why would people want to suffer? Well, we don't want to suffer. And that's why most people in our day parrot the party line, however often it changes. You want to be persecuted, say something different than the powers that be. But the people that are claiming to be persecuted are, in fact, always in lockstep with them. Because of this, their pagan gods are satisfied and their wrath is temporarily stayed because their worshipers have once more submitted to the editing of reality. Thus, they will not be made to suffer for rejecting the perpetually new orthodoxy. And yet again, there is something in suffering that we very much need. So where genuine suffering is not, we manufacture it. But again, why? Well, because human beings have souls and souls seek significance beyond mere biological utility or duty or responsibility. We have got to be identified with some great suffering struggle. We need this. This is why so many backstories from so many comic book heroes that I grew up reading were so tragic. This one's whole family died in some situation. This one's whole civilization died and this shaped them. That kind of storyline is compelling. And it makes sense that that sort of a person who was forged in that kind of a furnace would achieve greatness. On the other hand, there's nothing compelling about a person who's never suffered. We all know this. Nor is there sufficient intellectual or emotional justification for heroism without a history of suffering. There has to be some cause. And by observation, the pampered don't tend to become paragons of courage and sacrifice. Heroes are brought about by pain. But who are the heroes of our day? Well, none, we are told, are more heroic than those in the LGBTQIA Oxford comma semicolon club. But we cannot lionize them as heroes if we do not establish their bona fide suffering. So we do. Even if we have to conjure it out of nothing, and conjure it we must, because in reality, they are the most coddled and celebrated group in existence. But then why do human beings seek significance in suffering in the first place? By whose design was this feature formed? Or what is this a response to? If, as with this, every single human being demonstrates a certain unction, that unction has got to be an attempt to satiate something real, some real need, some real desire. And we recognize this with physical needs and the attempt to satisfy them. We pursue in this life temporally things that reflect physical realities. I'm a biological being, therefore I require food and water, therefore I seek it, and I eat and I drink to satisfy those needs. But obviously the need for suffering is not rooted in biology, it is rooted in spirituality. This is not the body seeking something, it is the soul. I'm seeking some sort of satisfaction, and this necessitates religion, whether of the formal kind or the informal kind. Suffering and religion have, in fact, always been inseparable. This is why some of the Hindus to this day starve themselves in a form of asceticism. It's why the falsely Christian Simeon the Stylite lived on top of a pole for 37 years. You might have heard about this gentleman, subjecting himself to unthinkable deprivation on account of his so-called Christianity. And the Bible very much acknowledges this natural human predilection. This was addressed by Paul in Colossians 2:20 through 23. If you have died with Christ to the elementary principles of the world, why, as if you were living in the world, do you submit yourself to decrees such as do not handle, do not taste, do not touch, or positively perhaps live on top of a pole for 37 years, which all refer to things destined to perish with use in accordance with the commandments and teachings of men. These are matters which have, to be sure, the appearance of wisdom and self-made religion and self-abasement and severe treatment of the body, but are of no value against fleshly indulgence. So the need for significance and the attempt to find it in suffering is ancient. But from what is this need derived, or what does it reflect? Well, there's room for more than one answer here, to be sure. But our manifest need to find significance in suffering is, in fact, and I think chiefly, an echo of the gospel. It is a reflection of true religion in even fallen man, because even fallen men still bear God's image. This is why a perversion of this is found in every single false religion, sparing none. Every sect or cult has its true believers who suffer for their austerity and their faithfulness and their righteousness, however righteousness may be defined. This is also the basis of their fellowship together as a community of practitioners of such and such a religion. We all suffer for this righteous cause, therefore we are all bound together by that suffering. This is certainly true of the alphabet religion. Again, their categories are ever expanding. Queer is growing day by day, and how we define that, and they're bringing in new people. This is how they evangelize. It's how they win souls, by just increasing what it means to be queer. They seek fellow worshipers, and they want deep fellowship with their fellow worshipers, so they seek common identification of queer with its many iterations, and they're all bound together by a common, if only fictional, suffering. And this is very clearly a tactic of the devil, and a very clever one. Because the deepest of human fellowship is, in fact, always based upon a common experience of suffering. You have two people in a church who have lost children, two couples who have lost children. They will quite naturally find each other, and they will understand each other on a level that other people cannot understand them. The same thing is true of abuse victims in a church or outside of it. Outside of the church, they have groups where people can go to with common experiences of suffering. If you're thinking on a national level, we are never so galvanized, at least when we had a healthy society, as we were when a foreign nation attacked us. We came together because we all shared in that suffering and experienced it communally. Our need to suffer in the relationships and communities we build around suffering does indeed echo, in very real senses, Christ's suffering and his people's share of it, and the depth of fellowship that we experience with him as a result of suffering like him for him. In our text today, we will hear and discern not the echo, but the original voice. And we will work through our text here this afternoon, verse by verse, exegeting and applying as we go. We're going to begin again in Acts 5:27 and go as far as verse 42, which is to say that we will round out the chapter here today. So verse 27, when they had brought them, they stood them before the council. The high priest questioned them, saying, we gave you strict orders not to continue teaching in this name, and yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and intend to bring this man's blood upon us. Now notice here how myopically self-absorbed these men in the Sanhedrin are. What is this whole thing about? The preaching of the apostles, the movement of the early church. It's about the salvation of the nation. It is about the salvation of the world. And where is their chief concern placed upon being made the villains in this narrative that they're being told? For them, it's not about Christ or salvation, nor even from a purely natural perspective, the murder of an innocent man. It is always and forever about them and about their reputations specifically. Continuing on in verse 29, but Peter and the apostles answered, we must obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom you had put to death by hanging him on a cross. He is the one whom God exalted to his right hand as a prince and a savior to grant repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. But when they heard this, they were cut to the quick and intended to kill them. In this section, we're reminded that the problem that people have with the gospel is not the fact that there is one. That's not the issue. Sanhedrin has no problem with the idea that God is, that God needs to be satisfied on behalf of sinners, that there needs to be a mediator to satisfy him, that there are villains and heroes in this story. The problem is that in their scheme of the gospel, they're the saviors, not the sinners. Peter's role is to explain to them that they are in fact not the saviors. They are among those desperately in need of salvation. God authored a great drama. All of it. Every single line, every word in it, every punctuation. And in this great drama, the arch-villain is who? He is Satan. But all his children are villains also. Satan thrust the human race into darkness, but the children born to darkness loved the darkness and they hated the light. And so because they love the darkness, they can hardly be considered victims of it. And Christ in this narrative is cast by God as the hero of mankind, carrying out the will of God by bringing salvation to us. It is not that the Sanhedrin reject the basic framework. It is simply that they have reversed the roles. Instead of Satan as the arch-villain, Christ is. And in their minds, this sets the apostles in the position that they themselves rightly hold, as the willful and culpable followers of the arch-villain. And well, they have falsely cast themselves as Christ. In our day, we are redefining biological reality moment by moment. But in every day, humans have redefined spiritual reality as we can see exemplified here. Now ask yourself, if you are convinced of this kind of a critical, life-defining delusion, how hard would you fight in order to keep that delusion intact if this is at the center of your being and everything that you have built forever? You have built upon this, and if it falls, everything on top of it will fall also. How hard do you fight to make sure it does not fall? You might fight hard enough to murder God's only son, had become incarnate. And then you can stop there. You'd murder any of his followers that came after him, because this kind of a lie, which is to say a lie that reaches down to the very core of your essence. It cannot be exposed to the light. Now, of course, for many of you, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Because whether it was me or it was somebody else in this congregation or outside of it, somebody was used by God to pull the blinders off of you and to show you perhaps that you were a false convert. This is a tremendous confrontation. And it's a confrontation that always comes as a consequence of sharing the gospel. If you enter a dark room at night and you flip on the light, are the occupants of that room going to love you for what you have done? Only if the source of that light is moving them to, which is the Holy Spirit of God. But if he's not moving them, then they're going to hate you for shedding light on what they fight so hard to keep hidden. And the reason for this is that you, and really your message, are the cause of a very real suffering in them. Now, the 70 members of the Sanhedrin, 70 plus one being the high priest, have different motivations. Some of them know exactly who they are and why they're doing what they're doing, and I think Caiaphas is in this camp. I don't think he's deceived. It's about money and power and all the things that come from those things. He's not a true believer. If it weren't this vehicle to those ends, it would be some other vehicle for him. But some of these men don't know who they are. If indeed Saul, who would become Paul, is among them, as we have posited, Paul is certainly a true believer. He's certainly a zealot for the cause. And he believes the cause to be just, and you can see this in his writings elsewhere. Saul will devour the church, all the while believing that he is the great protector of God's people and God's work. And Saul's going to have that blindfold ripped off by Christ himself. But what of the true believers in this or other false religions that won't? Well, they're going to suffer greatly as a result of our message. I think of the example, a metaphor perhaps, of a kid entering a souvenir shop with a snow globe. And in the snow globe, there's this scene that is serene. You have a couple skaters on the ice, and you have a person on a bench, a parent perhaps, and they're watching these children in this peaceful scene. And then you have this little kid, and he picks up the snow globe, and instead of doing what he's supposed to do and just turn it over so that there's this nice fall of snow, he shakes it ferociously like little children do, and it turns into a Cat 5 hurricane plus a snowstorm. That's what you're doing to people when you give them the gospel and tell them that they're sinners. You're drudging up all that stuff from the bottom of their soul and shaking it all around. We lose sight of this. We who've been in this faith for a really long time, it becomes perfunctory. Oh, you're a sinner, and you're deserving of the wrath of God. To them, it is cataclysmic, very often. For those whom the Lord is saving, the knowledge of their sin causes suffering that leads to their salvation. For those whom the Lord is not saving, the knowledge of their sin imparted by our preaching is going to lead them to want to destroy us. And if they can, they're going to. Again, verse 33, but when they heard this, they were cut to the quick and intended to kill them. And yet, for the apostles, by the grace of a sovereign God, through the decree of a false teacher, no less, that end result is postponed at least for a little while. Continuing in verse 34, but a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, respected by all the people, stood up in the council and gave orders to put the men outside for a short time. And he said to them, men of Israel, take care what you propose to do with these men. For some time ago, Thaddeus rose up, claiming to be somebody, and a group of about 400 men joined up with him. But he was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing. After this man, Judas of Galilee rose up in the days of the census and drew away some people after him. He too perished, and all those who followed him were scattered. So in the present case, I say to you, stay away from these men and let them alone. For if this plan or action is of men, it will be overthrown. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow them, or else you may even be found fighting against God. Now, first off, let's understand some things about Gamaliel. Who was the greatest teacher in actuality in the history of the nation of Israel? It was Jesus. Who was considered to be, by the powers that be, was Gamaliel. This is the institutional man, the one that they accepted as filling that role, a preeminent teacher. Gamaliel was the dean and star professor, so to speak, of the most influential and sought-after school for theologians in his day. You may recall that at a later point, Paul is going to invoke his name as his teacher to establish his bona fides in front of his Hebrew brethren. So if the question is, as it should be, what kind of a man has such influence as to be able to turn away his peers from their murderous rage in the moment and back to reason, you have your answer. A man who has absolute respect and authority, and who has earned it. Gamaliel himself is one of the true believers that we just raised. He's not here for the same reasons that Caiaphas is. For money or power, Gamaliel believes what he teaches. And when it comes to false teachers, there are two categories according to Scripture. And we have articulated this in the past. There are those who knowingly deceive others, who know that their practice of religion is nonsense, but they're going to milk whatever they can out of the people that follow them. And then there are those who are deceived and therefore deceiving others. They believe falsely, and then they lead others down that same false path. This is Gamaliel's situation. Because he has still not accepted Christ, he is certainly not a true teacher. Nevertheless, his counsel inarguably reflected the kind of wisdom that only comes from either age or astute observation of the record of history, or in fact, as I think, both. What does he say to them? He says, some of you, perhaps, whippersnappers, youngsters, haven't been around for very long, so let me tell you the way that things go. It was this guy once, and he came along, and he was a smooth talker, and got a lot of people to follow him, kicked up a lot of dust, and a lot of people got concerned, but in the end, it all came to naught. And then there was another who came after him, and it all came to naught. So before everybody gets their feathers ruffled, and all you young guys go to war over this thing, give it time. Give it space to breathe. Let it peter out on its own, if indeed it is going to. But his counsel was also biblical. That is, his greatest student would yet write in Romans 8, if God be for us, who can be against us? If God's with it, you're not going to be able to stop it. So leave it be in either respect. And finally, his counsel also reflected the orthodoxy of his general era. In the second century, a rabbi named Yohanan said this, every assembly which is in the name of heaven will finally be established, but that which is not in the name of heaven will finally not be established. Amen. In the immediate context, we're often unable to see the truth of this, but in the ultimate sense, it's certainly true. And it is no more true than with the ecclesia or the assembly which belongs to Christ. For 2,000 years, Satan has ravaged us, and yet we thrive. And if the Lord should tarry another 10,000 years, we will still be thriving then, because we have indeed been established in the name of heaven. Now, one does wonder, at least I wonder, will we someday meet Gamaliel in heaven? I'm not aware that history records what happens next in his life, but perhaps. If he follows his own reasoning and lives long enough to observe what continues to happen in the church, and the Lord uses those things in his heart and his soul to move him to salvation, then maybe. Continuing in verse 40, they took his advice, and after calling the apostles in, they flogged them and ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus and then release them. Now, this flogging is certainly lighter than the punishment that they were probably going to receive, which would have been stoning, which in every situation all the time ends in death, but this was certainly not light. In all probability, they received the maximum number of lashings allowed by God's law, which was 39. Same number, of course, that Christ received prior to his crucifixion. So, because we have not read yet together what comes next in the text, and the apostles' response to this, Let us discuss their response first in terms of potentialities, what may come, and let us draw these potentialities from our own personal experience and the experiences of others who claim to be Christians, and some of whom very much are. So response number one, or possible response number one, they stopped speaking in Jesus' name per the command. Lots of really good justifications for this. We already said our piece. We said this in the past. Our position is already known. To just keep pressing and pressing and pressing and creating what appears to be unnecessary conflict is just going to be a bad testimony. So let's just leave sleeping dogs lie and stop poking the bear over and over again. Or here's a really good one. If we are jailed or dead, which is going to happen as a consequence of our continued preaching, then we can't preach the gospel anyways. So isn't it better to live to fight another day? Let's be prudent about this thing. Or look how much we have already accomplished. Is it not enough? Tens of thousands have now come in the name of Jesus. If we just let this machine run on its own momentum, it will continue to gain souls. Perhaps we don't need to push so hard as we have been. Or there is also, we're just tired of suffering. For 3 years with Jesus, we were up, we were down, we had thousands of followers, we had ourselves only. The next moment, we watched our Messiah die in horrifying manner. Now we have received and are receiving the ire of the Sanhedrin. We are on the precipice of death. It's time for somebody else. Or possible response number two. They followed the example of Job prior to repentance, which happened at the end. And they, you know, go the whole, woe is me, is God really good? Where is God in all of this? I did everything right. Why is this happening to me? Where in the Bible, after all, does it say that Christians should have to suffer? Notwithstanding every single page, but I mean other than every single page, where does it say that Christians should have to suffer for righteousness' sake? Possible response number three. They defy the order, and they use their defiance to become internet superstars. They use it in the same way that that gentleman on the pole used his position. He became a tourist trap. And they continue to perform righteous acts, but they make sure that John in the church, different John than the apostle, the one whose spiritual gift is YouTubing, is always present to see it. Or potential response number four. They defy the order to the glory of God and with full hearts, counting it all joy. Spoiler alert, it is the fourth option there. Verse 41, continuing. So they went on their way from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they had been considered worthy to suffer shame for his name, and every day in the temple and from house to house, they kept right on teaching and preaching Jesus as the Christ. You know why you respond that way to these sorts of things? Because you know who you are. You know who you are. You know that you're a herald of salvation. And you know that of all the things that people busy themselves with, none are so critical as this. Therefore, we don't ever let the powers that be dictate to us when, how, or if we preach Christ. We preach Him always, anyways, period. We will not be cudgeled. We will not be manipulated. Christ is King, not you. Now, the final issue I want to address with all of you today is, why the joy? Why is Christian suffering joyful? First, let's step back just a little bit and acknowledge that the disciples being joyful in their suffering did not mean that they were smiling as they were being beaten ruthlessly 39 times or laughing. That's not Christian joy. It's just absurd. Christian joy and suffering isn't some masochistic grin or laughter in the face of anguish. It's a deep sense of who God is and that he loves you, and a possession of the experience of that love in the midst of that anguish that makes you quite transcendent. But with that said, the answer to why can we and do we suffer with joy is that our suffering, along with that of the apostles, connects us to Jesus. To suffer like Jesus for Jesus is to enter the deepest possible fellowship with Jesus. Do you remember when we acknowledged at the beginning that the deepest kind of human fellowship is always based upon a common experience of suffering? And I gave you a couple examples. Let me give you another one. Lydia and I, and this is not like a woe is us kind of a story, we have suffered much in the 2 decades now that we have been together. And we have experienced those sufferings together. And so Lydia can at times, and does, convey the nature of that suffering to other people for various reasons, often to offer encouragement or wisdom that was gained through that suffering. And those people that she's speaking to can have some knowledge of what she's saying, some understanding of it. Can any of them have the same kind and depth of knowledge of that suffering that I do? No, because I was there and I experienced it as she did. And so we are bound together by that suffering in a way that no other person could be by that particular suffering and the progression of it through the last 2 decades. It is the same way with Christian suffering. Jesus was in his mortality, according to Isaiah 53, what? A man of abounding happiness, always smiling? No, he was a man of sorrows and grief. So if deep fellowship is based upon common suffering, then suffering as Christ, for Christ, is the only way to truly know Christ. Indeed. Now, Peter pretty obviously understood this based upon the observation of Acts 5 in his response. But because nothing clarifies like explicit statements, here is 1 Peter chapter 4, starting in verse 1 and skimming. Therefore, since Christ has suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same purpose. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal among you which comes upon you for your testing, as though some strange thing were happening to you. But to the degree that you share the sufferings of Christ, not the sufferings of poop happens, or I made bad decisions, or we live in a messed up world, but the sufferings of Christ, keep on rejoicing, so that also at the revelation of his glory you may rejoice with exultation. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. Why, I ask you, did Jesus say, pick up your cross and follow me, to the disciples in the immediate, but also to us in the ultimate sense? It is not as though the cross was the only implement of death and suffering in his day. The Romans were nothing if not creative when it came to torturing people and murdering them. But it was by the cross that Jesus suffered and died. So Jesus was not there inviting us to any suffering at all. He was inviting us to his suffering, to join in it and to fellowship with him in it. Now our crosses save no one. But nevertheless, they are our crosses. My mom used to say a certain thing when she would see a mother in maybe a grocery store or just in maybe a residence moving from one room to the next. What do little children do when mom gets up? They follow her everywhere. Sometimes they don't, and then you have to beat them. But other times they quite naturally do. And my mom would say, there they go like little ducks in a row. They are quite evidently as such the children of that particular mother. They belong to her undeniably. It is the same with us when we walk behind our Lord with our crosses, him first, us behind him. Peter and company are rejoicing because of the severe beating they just received, because the way that they suffered and what they suffered for identifies them with Christ as nothing else could. And given that Jesus was a man of sorrows, it brought them into his fellowship to a greater extent than any other temporal experience could. Now, they certainly did not suffer to the degree that Jesus suffered, or obviously, again, to the same effect, they did suffer for righteousness, i.e., they suffered by the will of God in obedience to the commands of God for the glory of God. And with Jesus, this was obviously always the case. He suffered for doing his Father's work. And he said that he was doing his Father's work all the time. The greatest example of this was John 17:4 in the preemptive prayer. I glorified you on the earth, having accomplished the work which you have given me to do. Speaking about ultimately the cross, which had not happened yet, but speaking about it in a way that demonstrated its inevitability. Jesus didn't suffer because of bad personal decisions, consequences of living in a fallen world. Certainly didn't suffer because he was anybody's victim. He made very clear that he was not, that he was victor. The Roman soldiers that nailed him to his cross were not, in the truest sense, servants of Caesar in this. They were proxies of God. It was God, the Father, who put Christ there to suffer for righteousness because he was uniquely worthy. Now, is Peter uniquely worthy? No. Nor the apostles along with him, nor any of us. But indeed, they were worthy because Christ had made them so. And so they are suffering in a very similar way. When verse 41 states that they went on their way from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they had been considered worthy to suffer shame for his name, understand that the one who had deemed them worthy was not any member of the Sanhedrin. It was not the Sanhedrin as a collective. It was God who considered them worthy. Like Christ and for the sake of Christ, as Paul wrote in Philippians 1:29, it had been granted to them not only to believe, but to suffer for his sake. Simply put, Christian, it is a privilege to suffer as Christ for Christ. And indeed, it is the greatest privilege any Christian can have. To suffer as Jesus suffered. Are many Christians who will tell you, perhaps all Christians, that the times when they have felt closest to Christ has been when some wave or another sent them crashing into the rocks hard. Is this surprising? Or should it be surprising, considering that he was a man of sorrows? If sorrow is what he was born for and born into, then of course sorrow, and as a result, suffering, is where you will feel him most and find him in the greatest sense. He is present most where you have the greatest pain. And this is so often missed by so many that confess Christ. They want a one-cross Christianity, which is to say a Christianity where the only one that had to suffer was Jesus for them, but not them for Jesus. They don't want a two-cross Christianity where only Christ's cross saves, where their cross sanctifies and their suffering glorifies him. Because they want the salvation that Jesus brings, but they don't want Jesus. Jesus is with the Christian in our happiness. He is with us in our prosperity. He is with us at all times, but he is uniquely with us in his suffering. And it is there that we uniquely discern him. Thus, if you are to learn the deepest truths about fellowship with Christ, you're not going to learn them here, really. You're not going to learn them in a pristine, ornate cathedral. You will learn them in a prison cell, either figuratively or literally, which you will occupy on account of we must obey God rather than men. So are you suffering for righteousness, Christian? If you are, know that Christ is there. And know that you have now an opportunity to know him in your pain as you never could in your prosperity. know also that you suffer a little while for him now, because he suffered much for you first. And he has marked you as his by placing your particular cross on your shoulders and leading you through the valley of the shadow of death. Now, for those of you who may be appropriating a form of this suffering as an exercise of mere religiosity, like we talked about in the beginning, I will only end in hell, and then you will discover what real suffering actually is. You're not saved by your suffering. Something weird that happens when you speak to people about the cost of discipleship, as I have, and I've seen this through the years, that inflames the passions of what I guess would be called the alpha male, except it exists within women as well. And they hear no grace in this. All they hear is, I can do this, and I can be better than somebody else, and I can be known by this, by my asceticism, by my refusal to indulge. And it becomes a great source of pride for them. That's not this. That's not what I'm talking about at all. What you're being invited to, it's the suffering of Christ. It is that suffering that is thrust upon you by a holy God, because you will live as he has commanded, irrespective of the way that the world is going around you. And the fellowship of his suffering is not something that you can enter into of your own volition. It is rather something that he brings you into by his love. And he does this through his cross, and by your faith in the work that he performed upon it, not for your glory, not to satisfy your own pride, and again, it is a privilege, and I pray that you will enter into the fellowship of his suffering today. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the opportunity to give your people your word. I thank you for the clarity and the power. And Lord, I pray that you bless us as we continue to navigate this life. Let us finish well. And I praise you and I thank you for these things in Jesus' name. Amen.